Buongiorno a tutti, iniziamo questa sessione, una sessione dedicata all'innovazione, dedicata agli hub di innovazione con una visione, una prospettiva internazionale. È una sessione mista, parleremo sia in italiano che in inglese, ma vorrei anche fare un saluto rapido alle persone collegate virtualmente a questa riunione da altre parti d'Europa. So thank you very much everybody for being here today and thank you all the European participants of this event. The objective today is to talk about innovation hubs throughout Europe and how we can create operative synergies to support innovation, particularly in sectors where we are much interested, like life sciences. So my name is Fabio Bianco. I'm the Chief Scientific Officer of Bio4Dreams. And I will only take a couple of minutes today to introduce you to the reasons why we thought it would be important to discuss about innovation from a different perspective. The perspective of hubs where you put together many different competences in one place to create operative synergies. So let's start from the very basics. What's innovation? Innovation, by definition, is the art of introducing new things, new ideas, new methods, new devices into a certain market. And in our life science field, there's so many different topics where this is today crucial of importance. This is just an example of how healthcare, those major topics like healthcare, agrotech, industry 4.0, digital, can really match together and crosstalk in the different thematic areas in order to create innovation. And I guess this is the real main core and main objective of innovation throughout different fields, to try to find synergies, operative synergies, to create value. Now, if we think about innovation, we always think that we're living somehow a bit behind with respect to other parts of the world. But it's true, that's not happening. Europe, as you can see from this scale, it's quite well positioned in terms of developing innovation. The major problem with respect to Europe is that Europe is very much fragmented, and innovation is not always the same throughout Europe. And we have a significant part of our continent who is lagging somehow behind with respect to the development of innovation and the transfer of innovation onto the market. And unfortunately, Italy is part of that yellow line where we would like to somehow support development. So one of the key missions that we as Bio4Dreams are trying to reach is to connect those places and try to unite forces in order to support the development of innovation throughout the different hubs. And that's because teamwork is important. This is not just a marketing slide. This is what Europe is telling us. The creation of cluster is increasing the development of startups, is increasing the development of bigger companies, the wages, and the overall development of the market. But it's a huge element that we need in order to support the development of a growing ecosystem in innovation. So, what we're going to do today is we're going to try to take a look at what is happening in many places of the yellow line that I showed you before throughout the central eastern part of Europe, where there are a lot of places that we call innovation hubs. What do we mean by innovation hub? We mean a place where there is good research, where there is good opportunities, good industry, interested in developing synergy, interested in transferring know-how onto the market. But many times there is something missing. It could be lack of internationalization, it could be lack of technology transfer culture. So the idea is to take the good things that are present in each ecosystem, whether they could be infrastructure, whether they could be specific tax opportunities, and try to merge them in order to support with the strength of one ecosystem the faults of the other ecosystems. And this is true for whatever type of activity you want to carry out in innovation, whether it has to do with the development of novel startups, whether it has to do with the development of projects like grants or international networks of research in order to develop novel IP, or whether it's co-development projects. And by doing this, we're not only creating an operative synergy throughout Europe and the different ecosystem to support innovation, but we also become attractive for players of other ecosystems that want to look at Europe as a player with whom to interact in order to bring forward innovation. And that is why I'm very happy to have with us, hopefully, if the connection works, also the Pennsylvania Biotech Center and the Sino-Italy Ningbo Ecological Park, which are two different realities in two different parts of the world with whom we are working closely in order to boost innovation throughout Europe. So with that said, I welcome you again to this session, and I will let the host of the house, Cristina Biasizzo from our Genova site, introduce what is happening in the first ecosystem that we're going to look into today, which is Genova and the Digital Innovation Hub developed here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fabio. Welcome, everybody. I'm Cristina Biasizzo from Genova. I'm an external relation and officer manager at Genova, and I'm speaking Italy. Allora, nel 2018 Bio for Dreams punta su Genova e apre la propria sede operativa inserendola all'interno dell'ex CBA al San Martino. E nell'arco del 2019 prende contatto con tutto l'ecosistema della ricerca, della formazione di alto livello di Regione Liguria, siglando degli accordi di partnership con innanzitutto l'Università di Genova, che come dimensioni è sicuramente il centro di ricerca più grande della regione, quindi con l'Istituto Italiano di Tecnologia, un'altra bella grande realtà che abbiamo qui, i due IRCS, il Policlinico San Martino e l'ospedale pediatrico Giannina Gaslini, e anche con l'ospedale Galiera, che come abbiamo potuto anche vedere questa mattina durante la tavola rotonda bellissima che è stata organizzata dal Polo Ligure Scienze della Vita, non è un IRCS, però è un ospedale ad alta specialità, dove la maggior parte dei device di domotica e di sensoristica vengono presi, diciamo, in carico e sperimentati sui pazienti, perché come sappiamo l'ospedale Galiera ha una percentuale di pazienti della terza e quarta età e quindi viene, diciamo, ha questa sua grande specificità e tutti questi device trovano una loro sperimentazione all'interno dell'ospedale Galiera. Una volta fatto questo raccordo e quindi instaurate queste interlocuzioni privilegiate con gli enti di ricerca del territorio, abbiamo iniziato a dialogare con la Confindustria e quindi siamo diventati soci del Digital Innovation Hub. Come voi sapete, i Digital Innovation Hub sono degli acceleratori di investimenti e di finanziamenti focalizzati per il 90% sull'aiuto alla digitalizzazione delle piccole, medie e grandi imprese, non solo anche sulla pubblica amministrazione, ma col mandato dell'Industria 4.0 e grazie alla presenza in Regione Liguria di uno degli 8 centri di competenza italiani, di cui è sede, stiamo pianificando una strategia operativa che vada incontro alle esigenze delle start-up, che comunque sono a tutti gli effetti delle SRL, nell'ottica del consentire l'internazionalizzazione delle stesse, favorire questo processo di internazionalizzazione. E come lo facciamo? Allora, grazie al binomio Confindustria e Digital Innovation Hub, poi tornerò indietro per illustrare meglio alcune dei tools che ha il digital per poter operare in questo senso. Bio4Dreams, insieme con l'altro incubatore certificato che è presente sul territorio ligure, che è Y-Lab, e che ha una fortissima focalizzazione sullo sport, mentre Bio4Dreams ha un suo verticale sulle scienze della vita, abbiamo proposto la creazione di una piattaforma digitale che sta per essere ultimata, attraverso la quale si possano effettuare collaborazioni con centri di ricerca e università sparse in tutto il mondo e soprattutto consentire anche alle start-up di poter accedere ai servizi di avanzamento digitale laddove ne avessero bisogno per diventare molto competitive sul mercato. Il modello che stiamo pensando di costruire grazie al Digital Innovation Hub e grazie alla Confindustria è il seguente. Siccome le grandi aziende spesso e volentieri investono direttamente sui progetti di ricerca, hanno una potenza economica notevole e quindi possono direttamente acquistare brevetti, progetti, mentre le medie aziende non hanno queste possibilità. Allora, il circuito che si vorrebbe venire a creare e che sarebbe un modello poi trasferibile in tutta Italia, quindi sarebbe un progetto pilota qui, poi trasferibile attraverso la rete dei Digital Innovation Hub in tutta Italia, è quello di creare incontri sia virtuali attraverso questa piattaforma, ma anche reali, fisici, in spazi fisici presso gli uffici di Confindustria per mettere in contatto aziende e ricercatori. Ma non c'è solo questo, non c'è solo questo. Fabio Bianco vi ha illustrato prima nella parte introduttiva come Bio4Dreams, sentita fortemente l'esigenza di internazionalizzare il lavoro che fa a favore delle proprie start-up, sta sbarcando sia in Cina che negli Stati Uniti. Grazie al DIT e alla Confindustria di Regione Liguria abbiamo attivato un contatto molto interessante con Accelerate Italy 42N, il cui founder è un genovese che è andato a vivere negli Stati Uniti, per la precisione a Boston, ha creato questa sorta di circuito, di network di aziende e di investitori che amano moltissimo la ricerca che si fa in Italia, stimano molto la preparazione dei ricercatori italiani e sono ben disposti e disponibili a valutare i progetti e a finanziarli. Di fatto il problema principale, ed è stato in questi due giorni di Meet in Italy, nei vari workshop spesso è venuto fuori, il problema principale che hanno i ricercatori in Italia, cioè quello di trovare degli investitori, perché uno dei primi problemi è proprio come sostenere finanziariamente ed economicamente gli spin-off e le start-up. È stato evidenziato come il sistema italiano sia poco performante da questo punto di vista, quindi il legislatore italiano non ha ancora delle misure che siano strategiche e che possano rendere veramente competitivi i lavori dei ricercatori italiani rispetto a come si fa ricerca nel resto del mondo. E la mancanza di questi strumenti che ti rendono competitivo è un grosso gap, perché la ricerca è internazionale, non è genovese, non è italiana, e l'innovazione, perché si compia, ha davanti a sé un panorama, un mercato che è internazionale, non è locale, quindi non esiste nemmeno il concetto ma la Liguria è più o meno performante rispetto alla Lombardia, piuttosto che la Toscana, piuttosto che la Campania, che adesso sta avendo un'esplosione di finanziamenti pubblici, di apertura di nuove strutture. Non si può ragionare in questi termini, perché hai davanti a te il mondo, cioè la tua competitività è il mondo. Quindi per cultura probabilmente l'Europa e l'Italia, se vogliamo guardare a casa nostra, diciamo che è un po' indietro rispetto al favorire il lavoro delle spin-off e delle start-up per farle approdare felicemente e velocemente a un mercato. Negli Stati Uniti e in Cina non è così. Non è così, perché credono molto di più innanzitutto nel capitale di rischio, quindi sono più disposti e favorevoli ad investire somme di denaro ingenti senza avere la sicurezza che nel giro di 3 anni porti a casa il risultato e quindi cominci ad avere dividendi. Sono più disposti quindi a rischiare anche il fallimento, cosa che in Italia è un concetto, diciamo, ancora quasi un tabù, non se ne può quasi parlare, e questo non fa bene di certo alla ricerca, ma soprattutto non fa bene a creare nel ricercatore la dimensione dell'imprenditore. Allora, il ricercatore puro fa per tutta la propria vita d'accademia, è contento così, ed è giusto che sia, ci mancherebbe altro, ha come sua priorità il pubblicare e non si vede in una dimensione imprenditoriale, non c'è niente di male in questo, ci mancherebbe altro. Ci sono però una nuova categoria, una nuova generazione di ricercatori che amano pensare che il frutto della loro ricerca possa diventare un'attività imprenditoriale da condurre felicemente all'exit e quindi al mercato, senza necessariamente dover aspirare a tutti i costi a diventare l'unicorno da $1 miliardo. E beh, e questo da noi è ancora una strada in salita e irta di tanti tanti ostacoli, soprattutto tanta tanta burocrazia. È di poche settimane fa, scusate l'inciso, anche la notizia, no, che nel sostegni bis il famoso Eneatec, che doveva essere dotato di ulteriori 400 milioni proprio per la ricerca biotech, si sono immediatamente tirati indietro e hanno tolto questo finanziamento da 400 milioni, adducendo come motivazione che in questo momento non era utile, non era competitivo, forse lo ritroveremo nel PNRR, ma forse non è detto. Allora, il fatto di consentire l'internazionalizzazione delle start-up, ed è questo il concetto che io ho voluto significare all'interno del Digital Innovation Hub e all'interno di Confindustria, è stato questo: internazionalizzare non significa favorire la fuga dei cervelli, significa che i cervelli italiani facciano ricerca in Italia, possano continuare a fare ricerca in Italia, ma possano avere una struttura legale tale per cui io vado a ricercare finanziamenti e mercati dove è più facile ottenerli. Quindi, con questa chiave di lettura, questo è il lavoro che Bio for Dreams sta facendo in questo momento all'interno del Digital Innovation Hub, all'interno di Confindustria e anche all'interno comunque del centro di competenza, che qui non ho citato, ma siccome per il progetto dello European Digital Innovation Hub a Mave, dove anche Unige e CNR sono soci e sono soci del centro di competenza, con la presidente Paola Girdigno, siccome la call tarda ad uscire, la Commissione europea sta tardando a far uscire la call per i progetti di EDIT, abbiamo pensato di incominciare a ragionare anche su altri temi che possono essere utili e performanti per la ricerca che facciamo in Liguria. Chiudo dicendo che il fatto di creare un sistema dove siamo comunque tutti uniti e tutti insieme in questo grande progetto, quindi l'unione fa la forza, perché l'Italia da questo punto di vista, l'Italia e la Liguria sono piccolini rispetto ad altri ecosistemi nettamente, che partono nettamente in vantaggio, come quelli che Fabio vi ha illustrato, sia dei paesi dell'Est Europa, dove c'è una tantissima ricerca di altissima eccellenza, poco propensa a fare trasferimento tecnologico perché è un concetto non ancora così conosciuto, e con mercati come la Cina e l'America, quindi collaborando e lavorando tutti uniti e tutti insieme, creare una massa critica e una forza che ci consentono di diventare appunto competitivi esattamente come tutti gli altri. E a questo scopo, anche per ribadire questo concetto di unione, io desidero fortemente ringraziare il professor Fabio Lavagetto, che è il prorettore al trasferimento tecnologico dell'Università di Genova e che è qui con noi oggi, il professor Fulvio Mastro Giovanni, che è il prorettore all'internazionalizzazione dell'Ateneo, anche lui con noi qui in presenza, la dottoressa Michela Spagnolo del CNR, con la quale abbiamo fatto un grandissimo lavoro come Polo Ligure Scienze della Vita proprio per creare il Meet in Italy for Life Sciences, e la dottoressa Silvia Morbelli, che è professore associato di medicina nucleare, perché tutta la parte che noi trattiamo come diagnostica di immagini, ecco, devo dire che il professor Sambucetti, suo mentore, e la professoressa Morbelli sono il mio contraltare continuo, quindi questo per testimoniare come la collaborazione tra di noi è costante, continua, su tutto, cioè non abbiamo preclusioni, se ci dobbiamo parlare perché dobbiamo creare qualcosa di importante e significativo, alziamo i telefoni e ci parliamo in un clima di grandissima serenità e di grandissima collaborazione, e per questo io ringrazio loro che sono qui e che con la loro presenza testimoniano l'attenzione a questo nostro workshop di oggi. Grazie.
Grazie mille Cristina, e non so se volete intervenire?
Ecco, Fabio, magari. Forse Fabio Lavagetto, che ve lo dico anche per chi è collegato, il professor Fabio Lavagetto, che ha un impegno poi fuori, allora gli diamo un gelato, un microfono gelato. Se poi, guarda, te l'hanno disinfettato, ma se ritieni tu hai i cappucci, metti il cappuccio.
Ringrazio delle parole che Cristina ha indirizzato a me personalmente, all'Ateneo e a tutti i colleghi che poi interverranno successivamente. La presenza di Bio4Dreams sulla piazza di Genova è un privilegio per noi, e quindi diciamo la collaborazione è solo all'inizio, ecco, nella sua infanzia, e crescerà sicuramente. Ecco, secondo quali linee? Ecco, anche nell'intervento di stamattina che ho fatto in un'altra occasione, ho sottolineato che gli Atenei da diversi anni ormai sono spinti in maniera competitiva ad ottenere risultati anche in termini sempre più di trasferimento tecnologico, di terza missione, di ricadute, di impatto sociale, culturale, economico. Quindi non basta soltanto pubblicare, non basta fare una buona didattica, bisogna continuare a fare tutto questo, ma bisogna anche avere dei numeri che testimonino l'impatto sull'economia reale che riusciamo a dare come istituzione. Quindi è un interesse primario per noi, per lottare per il budget, per sopravvivere, per competere, riuscire a essere performanti anche su questi territori. Lo sviluppo del valore della ricerca e la consapevolezza del valore che si sta sviluppando purtroppo è un problema culturale certamente genovese, ma probabilmente anche lo estendo a tutto il paese, ecco. E è proprio una difficoltà nelle generazioni, soprattutto un pochino precedenti alla mia, quello di attribuire proprio attenzione a attribuire valore alle cose che stanno facendo, e quindi sentirsi proprio impegnati non solo a scrivere un paper, ma che quella cosa possa diventare scaturire qualche beneficio e ricaduta. Ecco, ora siamo chiamati a fare questo. Quindi da una parte lo facciamo naturalmente facendo scouting sempre più di quelle che possono essere idee valide dai nostri laboratori. Siamo un'università generalista, abbiamo nell'asset sanitario, medico-sanitario, anche in quello ingegneristico-tecnologico, degli asset importanti. Ecco, diciamo, la competizione che noi facciamo con gli altri atenei in Italia e con gli altri atenei internazionali è proprio soprattutto su questi asset. Ecco, e si dimostrano capaci, stanno dimostrando capaci di generare molte idee che possono essere trasferite in idee imprenditoriali, e questo lo abbiamo fatto da tanti anni. Ecco, diciamo che abbiamo in questo momento circa oltre un centinaio di brevetti che stiamo valorizzando, alcuni in particolare in area bio in questi ultimi proprio settimane, ecco, in maniera sorprendente, e abbiamo oltre 40, forse 45 spin-off. Io sono stato prorettore alla ricerca e al trasferimento tecnologico anche una decina di anni fa, per 6 anni, e eravamo partiti con un progetto finanziato dal MISE per fare questo. Li abbiamo fatti, ma abbiamo continuato a farli anche a progetto esaurito. Ecco, chiaro, serve una forza che in questo momento il Ministero dello Sviluppo Economico non sta dandoci più su quella direzione, e che speriamo ci dia di nuovo attraverso, diciamo, un'alleanza territoriale. Ecco, allora, in quest'ottica che noi come Ateneo stiamo introducendo delle innovazioni nel nostro modo di stare insieme. Ecco, innovazione non è solo tecnologica, è anche organizzativa, e darsi delle regole più efficienti, più efficaci, di cui Cristina è stata messa da subito a conoscenza. L'abbiamo coinvolta gratis, naturalmente, e con grande piacere, nella commissione di valutare dei proof of concept in un bando che abbiamo vinto col Ministero dello Sviluppo Economico. È ancora impegnata perché i progetti stanno continuando ad arrivare, diciamo, avanti. Hanno fatto un primo trimestre, quindi ne dovranno fare almeno un altro e forse un terzo. Ecco, noi vogliamo spingere sempre più fuori dai nostri laboratori gli spin-off, perché ci stanno troppo bene. Ecco. Evidentemente i regolamenti e le norme che avevamo fissato all'epoca gli hanno dato una culla con tanta bambagia, non si sentono sufficientemente stimolati a misurarsi, e lo stesso i nostri proprietà intellettuali e brevetti spesso giacciono, diciamo, un polverati, e la tensione verso i TRL più alti non è così sentita. Ecco, uno crede di aver fatto già il suo, no, è appena cominciato. Ecco, allora, il lavoro che stiamo facendo con Bio4Dreams e che vorremmo fare in coordinamento anche con altri incubatori, Y-Lab per esempio, ma anche Fils, che è, diciamo, un soggetto pubblico, quindi non soltanto soggetti privati, è orientato sempre più, diciamo, a mettere il pepe sulle parti più sensibili del corpo dei nostri, che qui non cito, dei nostri colleghi. Ecco. E quindi il regolamento nuovo spinge fuori dopo 3 anni i nostri spin-off, non li spinge nel vuoto, nel baratro, ma li spinge su uno scivolo verso gli incubatori e verso l'internazionalizzazione. Da questo punto di vista è la chiave, certo. La chiave. Quindi benissimo, lo sfrutteremo moltissimo, e spero che questo sarà fatto in sinergia con tutti gli enti di ricerca del territorio.
Grazie mille per il suo intervento, e lo dico in inglese per switchare un po' rispetto ai nostri colleghi stranieri. So, our friends from Genova just mentioned a few keywords which I signed and I think are very important: the culture of failure, first thing, which is not present in our ecosystem; the basic research versus applied industrial research approach; the concept of technology transfer; the concept of public-private partnership for taking this approach towards the market. And another word that I think is very important, which is ecosystem, and the idea of creating an area and somehow a network where all of the different stakeholders, each doing its own job, can really bring forward know-how and knowledge towards the market. And to this aim, I would like to introduce the next speaker, who is representing here one of the most promising ecosystem in Italy, which is Stefano Minini, director at MIND, the Milano Living Lab. So Stefano, thank you very much for being here today, and the set is yours for explaining to us what's really happening in Milano at MIND.
Thank you very much, and thanks everyone for today. Yes, I'll give a quick view of what's happening at MIND, and I want to reconnect to the three key topics that were mentioned: the failure element, and I'll tell you why, the importance of public-private partnership, and the creation of an ecosystem. But let me give you a bit of a spoiler. our secret sauce is that we try to combine the creation of an ecosystem at an urban scale. So too often when we discuss and talk about innovation district, we forget about the physical space. And we forget that, you know, innovation typically stems from a nice chat over a queue for a coffee. And therefore, to create that, you have to have your talents. Granted, you have to have your machinery, but you have to create the occasion for the ecosystem actually to collide and to come to fruition. This is the story of mine, of Milan Innovation District. It's a story that starts from Expo 2015. Probably some of you have been there back in 2015 and have experienced how Italy in general can deliver a large scale event and turn that into a success. At the end of Expo, 20 million people have gathered in the area, so there was a huge immaterial legacy. And the public sector tried to leverage this immaterial legacy and tried to say, why don't I capitalize on that and try to get quickly money out of this venture? And it's kind of a failure because there was a tender for the entire area, and it was simply too big, and no real estate player wanted to get through it. So the public sector needed to reassess their own view of life and really become the deus ex machina to some extent, or the promoter of a much more complex system of stakeholders that are a public-private partnership on steroids, which is basically what is mined today. I'll try and share a couple of charts so that you can see a bit more about what I'm saying. I don't know if you can see them yet. Probably you are in a second.
Yes, we can.
All right, super. So in a nutshell, what you see at Mind today is one of the largest innovation district definitely on the Italian arena. You're talking about 1 million square meters, half and half public and private development, with a large investment that largely come from abroad, from Lendlease, which is my company, an international company, with a 10-year construction pipeline and 99-year concession between the public and the private sector to be developed. But most importantly, this innovation district is a community. As an innovation district, really looks at three key assets. The economic assets, all the talent, the resources, and the good sort of value that my predecessor clearly outlined on the Genovese scale. We have similar assets in Milan. But then you have networking assets, the opportunity to interact. We came up with a model to have this interaction. And finally, the physical asset, because as I was saying, there's nothing like a coffee at the end of this conversation. Starting from the economic asset, what we had put together at Mind is a set of what we call public anchors. They're not necessarily public stakeholder, but they have a public function. So you have a large university campus, Università degli Studi di Milano, La Statale, that will move the entirety of their scientific faculties back into Mind. And you're talking around 20,000 between students and researchers. So large scale, highly tech university that will bring there, for example, pharmacy, medicine, chemistry, and a bunch of other faculties. Then you have a research hospital that is now completing construction and will be available in 2022. Again, not just hospitals, but research in the cardiological and the traumatological sector. And then you have Human Technopole that you probably heard of as one of the leading research centers in Italy, primarily focused on genomics. It's always funny because my job is mainly to develop a construction site on a day-by-day basis. But it's heartwarming when I see researchers going in and out from Mind with their scooter, going out for lunch and actually mingling. And that means that we're doing something real for real people. So we started from these three key economic assets that at the even lower layer have the phenomenal amount of patents and the phenomenal amount of research talents that is available in at the Lombardy region level, but also at the macro scale at the Italian stage. And we say, how can we can make those people talk to one another? How we can accelerate this typical phenomenon that happens in Silicon Valley, whereby you know people just meet and they create a startup and everything is actually frictionless. What we did, we basically invented and patented and made a method called federated innovation. I'm not going to dwell into too much into the details of it, but the core idea is that we created layer-based infrastructure whereby large and small companies can interact with one another and be put in relationship with research partners, institutional partners, innovation partners like Bio4Dreams. And I think the key value into that is that we as Lendlease, the private developer of the area, decided to make a step back or a step on the side. We decided to say, look, you are a company, you want to bring innovation here, you pay a fee and you create a company, you create a legal entity that together manages the ecosystem of innovation. So far we have over 30 companies that signed up into that scheme. Typically the one that starts with an A are AstraZeneca, Accenture and ABB. So you're talking about really the top tier in their field. And as I was saying, they are coming to mind to do a couple of things. The first is to talk to one another. Cross technology and cross boundaries in the pre-competitive stage. They also want to have a first look down into the pool of startups and incubators that you have in the business community. And finally, they are looking to influence the strategic decisions about the site because essentially the Federated Innovation Representative and the ambassadors of each thematic area sit within the strategic committee and can actually drive the decisions on how innovation is made. So really, it's an engine that started and now is growing in its own right. And just last week, we presented our Federated Innovation Agenda on a set of thematic areas that are deeply focused on life sciences, but have a number of other important elements, all connected with the City of the Future. Because City of the Future is the second important layer of our innovation specialization. And why? Because we just don't live through sort of patents and proteins. We also live through interaction and the creation and the opportunity to create a futuristic city. Just a few glimpses on how Lendlease together with this partner is building this. As I was saying, we are looking at a million square meters, a town of nearly 70,000 people at its completion, that will grow over time in the next 10 years, with the idea of having a large common ground infrastructure where people can actually interact and freely interact in a green, accessible, permeable space where water takes a central stage, and when opportunities to have meaningful interaction are fostered by good urban design. We're looking at a space with high accessibility, where you know the use of public transport is facilitated and contributes to decarbonization, to a strong decarbonization agenda. Our decarbonization topics are not just on transport, however. We are acutely aware that around 40% of the construction business accounts for around 40% of the impact in terms of CO2 globally. And we are heavily looking with this company that I showed you before to bring down this emission level, not just with transport, but also with sustainable buildings, which means we are going to use structural timber for the first time on high altitude building, but also in reducing the construction waste. 98% of the construction waste from Expo 2015 has been recycled. And finally, we are looking into developing the first proof of concept. And this is when Bio4Dreams gets the central stage. From the end of 2021, Bio4Dreams will take a space together with a bunch of other tenants in the Mind Village, which is essentially the proof of concept of the vision that I just told you. It's going to be a space for around 1,000 people that will take three main functions. A first function for incubation and life sciences labs and spaces for life sciences startups. And this is where Bio4Dreams will double down on their capabilities to do both the laboratory and the advisory. And then there are going to be offices for larger corporates and smaller startups, both in the sense of desks that you can rent on a daily basis, but also in the sense of more established offices. For example, just in front of Bio4Dream, AstraZeneca will move their Italian headquarters. So you start to see why this ecosystem is starting to ramp up. And thirdly, we want to create a livable place, an exciting place. So we are closing with a large retailer to come up with a bistro and retail facility where you can do your grocery at the end of the day. But also there's going to be a gym, there's going to be an auditorium for 70 people, there's going to be an open park, and we are organizing on a weekly basis drinks of the community. So really what we are trying to do at Mind is to combine deep tech excellence in life science and our anchor are fantastic in doing that with creating a safe and sustainable and most of all after 18 months of screen talk, a nice and exciting place to live. So very much I'm looking with a lot of attention about the other stories that we are going to discuss today, and very much we are looking at other innovation districts as examples of interaction. We don't see Mind as a vacuum cleaner that sucks energy. We are actually looking at developing sector of specialization and exchanging talents and exchanging best practices, because we feel that the market, even the Italian market for innovation, is too small. And I echo what was said before that together we can make a difference. This is the message I want to give. Let's not pigeonhole ourselves into small districts and small sort of towers, because the expansion is out there. So watch this space, and hopefully we hope to see you very soon.
Stefano, thank you very much. Thank you for presenting the growing ecosystem in Milano. But now let's switch to another ecosystem, which is really a city of innovation, which we have in Italy, in particular in Trieste. So I'm very, very happy that Engineer Diego Bravar has joined us. Buongiorno, Ingegnere. We'll be very happy to listen about what is happening in Trieste, and in particular, what is happening at the Urban Center, this incredible public-private partnership that was really established in the beautiful city of Trieste. Ingegnere, buongiorno.
Buongiorno. So thank you very much. I want to present the Trieste Innovation Hub that is started in one region that's most innovative region in Italy, and the reason was because we have a elevated number of university research institutions and researchers, some 10,000 researchers, and 37 researchers for 1,000 employees in this area. And these researchers started, why we have in Trieste, in this region, all these researchers? Because Italian government, we was in the border of the Iron Curtain, put in Trieste area for 40 years, something around 300 million euros. So with this high concentration of researchers has allowed but to grow the provincial high density of innovative startups in Trieste, which is the highest in Italy, and as well, we are with Trento, as density, has helped to transform Friuli Venezia Giulia region in one strong innovative region. In the other end, my idea and our idea is that for innovation, we need a private sector that started to make industrial innovation. So as BioValley Group, it's a family and friends office, we started in 1915 the incubation acceleration project for the biotech target company. So for me, biotech is a biomedical, so medtech industry, biotech industry, and IT, medical IT, and big medical data analysis. So is a market to international level biotech or around 300 million euro, and medtech, and only Europe is 100 billion euro. So in Italy we have 30 billion euro on medtech industry. So other 30 million euro less are around for biotech and bio-ICT. So we invested in this kind of company, and we reach, if you want, in minority, we invested, and in majority for starting to grow acceleration process of this company. Now, my idea is in the following 3 years, the growth accelerator process of the digital and tech target company. So the idea is, as a private, we want private companies, we want to accelerate the innovation. We are in a region that there are 200 startups that are growing during the year, and there are, these startups are working in different cities of the region. We are a region of 1,200,000 inhabitants. 50% of the startups are in the information and communication technology. After, as you know, the employees in one startup is more or less 3 employees. More or less, the startup are doing 150,000 euro, yes. And what is important? The important is that there are some places in the region where, some example, in Trieste, with the 16% of the inhabitants have the 55% of the startup. The reason is because we have a lot of researchers. About the biotech sector industry, so we have in our small region something around 2,000 employees in this sector, only for in the large company, and 5,000 employees in all the company, and of these 5,000, only 300 employees are in the micro company. But this micro company represents the 52% of the total company, that's 172. How we try with the other player, try to improve the acceleration of the incubation, the growth process, the biotech startup until 2 years ago, we try to put together university, research hospital, research centers, and private. In the other end, for incubation. For accelerated the growing of the company, we have science and technology park or business innovation center with the school of management and industrial association. And education, yes, industrial education for the technicians. Since 2020, the municipality of Trieste started a public and private partnership for the Trieste Urban Center management, and the public provide to the private a cash approximately 1 million euro for 3 years for the management supply of 3 areas of the urban center structure of Trieste and 3 ICT system solution for the urban center. This management is done from Bio4Dream, BioValley Group, a business innovation center and other ICT company. And the project is to place this urban center as an international innovation hub dedicated to innovation, focus on the incubation acceleration, and engaged in the cross-functional contamination. And this urban center has three floors. Yes, ground floor for demo fab lab, first floor for functional contamination activity, second floor for offices and laboratory. I hope that we are able to put in the third floor for startups and spin-off. So after, without going in detail of what we are doing, we have in the same city another place that is Business Innovation Center that this year, in 2021, pass from a public management from Friulia to a private management, BioValley Investment Partner. What happened? What is this Business Innovation Center? Yes, there are 7,000 square meters, more or less, but it was a Business Innovation Center that started 30 years ago, more or less, after Genova. So Genova and Trieste started the first two Business Innovation Center, and in the Business Innovation Center of Trieste, approximately 300 companies were set up in the incubator since 89. Today, we have 50 innovative companies. The percentage of the occupied area are 98%. Average time of settled innovation company is 4 years. And we have more or less 370 units. This, the turnover growth of the settled innovative companies go from 21 million euro to 64 million euros in 19. And more or less on 50 companies, 21 are in the biotech or healthcare sector with the related services, and ICT other 11. Spin-off, yes, that we have our startups are coming from University and Research Center 5 and from Industry 9. So this is for saying that we are doing what we can in this space, Business Innovation Center, for accelerating the growing of the company in Trieste. In the other end, in the urban center, we try to accelerate the incubation now, from now. But the problem is how to collaborate with other other innovation center. And for this reason, every year, now from 5 years, we are organizing this Euro Biotech events where we organize conferences on research for innovation, for education for innovation, the finance for innovation, and policy for innovation. And after, our startup or small or medium-sized company can present biomed or biotech on bio-CT product and services. So researchers, entrepreneurs, and managers or policy makers are coming from 10 countries this year. We're connected via web to attend the conferences, the presentation of these new biotech products and services. In the event 2021 has been organized by our network or company, because I believe that the private sector must manage the innovation, improve the innovation, obviously with the support of the public research institute and university. But we need more private. And my idea is that, say to you, could the event 2022 be organized also with the support of other innovation hubs like yours? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the proposal, which I think will be a topic of discussion also in the near future. And then I would like to welcome you all to this trip towards the Eastern European side. So we started from Genova, going to Milan, now Trieste. The next player will be Hungary, and so I would like to welcome Vladimir Kocsubey, the Tech Transfer Innovation and International Relation Manager of the Szent Agatai Research Center at the University of Pécs, to whom I ask to give us an overview of what is happening in Hungary in terms of innovation landscape. Vladimir, jó napot!
Jó napot! Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the opportunity and listening to
all the presentations and the speeches, I can also be very pleased to join such an inspiring community and environment. I prepared not a long presentation. Let me share with it with all of you. If you can see.
Yes, we can.
Great. Then I start my short demonstration. So, I'm from St. Agatai Research Center from the University of Pécs. Pécs is located in southern Hungary. We are one of the, let's say, I think the second or the third biggest university in the country. Our focus at the university are life sciences, and the St. Agatai Research Center also focusing on life sciences, and I will show you some details of the Hungarian innovation landscape, as I was asked, and then tell you a few words about St. Agatai Research Center and the approach to innovation in Hungary from a perspective of a research institute. So as you can see on this chart, Hungary side by side with Italy, it's very interesting, I just noticed the fact. We are among the middle emerging innovation, innovating countries of the European Union with some similar numbers and figures of performance. What is very important from Hungarian perspective is the EU financing, the EU Horizon programs, which are focusing on science and research and innovation and development. And there you can see that all together from the almost 100 billion euros to be disseminated in the next 5 to 6 years in the European Union, 2 billion are planned to arrive in Hungary, and out of the 2 billion in the relevant fields of interest, I mean life sciences research and biology and medical sciences, we expect countrywide around 700 million euros to be obtained. Why it is important? Oh, yes, sorry. Why it is important? Because as you can see that in this field, the research funding of Hungary is mainly coming from, at this moment until now, coming from government and EU budgets, EU grants, and I'm happy also to show you this chart on the right side, where you can see that the biggest stakes from EU research financing in life sciences came to E Group. They are the first, and at the end of the list you can see the University of Pécs also with its institute. E Group, why is it important? Because you will see on a slide in a few moments that E Group is one of our biggest partners in innovation. Just to see you where we are, just to show you where we are, this is our tiny but I think very nice research center in the southern part of Hungary, as I mentioned, in Pécs. Of course, listening to the scales of the Milan Innovation Hub or Center, Mind and Trieste, we are a tiny one, we are a tiny country, and a tiny city and a tiny research center. I've heard, if I'm correct, that around 70,000 people will be engaged in the Mind when it will be in operation. Well, altogether, the inhabitants of our city, Pécs, are not much more than 130. So then let's go to the numbers. SRC, I mean here, St. Agatai Research Center, in numbers, I can demonstrate who we are. We have 19 research groups, mainly in life sciences. five associated members, some similar function in seven clusters. We run around 100 research projects with around 200 researchers. Of course, the 100 research projects are all together, the projects are running in the house. The focus is, as usual, are on the top 10 to 20 priority projects. What is very sound value and achievement of the research center, which was established, founded, directed 9 years ago, almost 10. Next year we will celebrate the 10th anniversary of the research center. That in these 9 years, we were able to publish more than 900 international publications, in mainly in Q1 and D1 papers. Why is it important? Because Santa Catarina Research Center is not an innovation hub yet. Santa Catarina Research Center, as you will see on one of my next slides, is becoming the engine, the center for innovation of the local innovation ecosystem. But at this moment, up to now, Santa Catarina Research Center can be proud of its sound scientific performance. That's true, that's no doubt that Santa Catarina Research Center in this very short period of operation, I mean 9 years, it's not a huge, not a very long time of for achieving international success, but Santa Catarina Research Center was able and still very active in achieving international recognition. We have established a year ago core facility system, which is very important from innovation point of view, because core facilities as service points, research service points for third parties, including industrial parties from Hungary and abroad, can be a very, very good and hot link to the market, to industry participants, players of the industry. We have two national laboratories. This is a new research infrastructure model introduced last year after the pandemics or during the pandemics in Hungary, and there are more than 10 national laboratories, research infrastructures were established by the government, and two of them are centered in our research center. What is important to mention also that we are participating members of 4+1, because the last one is not accredited yet by the European Union, but it will happen this year. So altogether 5 European research infrastructures, which provide international access to these top-level infrastructure research infrastructures, including our infrastructures. You can see on the right side the focus areas, the scientific focus areas, mainly neurosciences and pharmacology, biology, immunology, translational medicine, which is also a very good approach towards innovation projects, since we can provide from the lab to through the clinics to the market full scale model for an innovation project. And of course, genomics and bioinformatics are leading, let's say, leading business. The values, as I already mentioned, of course, if I start with our size and our location, then at the same time, being small, tiny, and young can be evaluated as some assets, some potential, because we've got quite a freedom what to do. We are, we have just elaborated our development strategy for the next 5 years. And as you can see, that innovation and technology transfer is in the focus of our strategy. It's also mentioned in the vision. Very important part, which counts for innovation and translational approach, is the intense collaboration with the clinics just right to the building in the neighborhood. So drug development, drug testing, drug repositioning and treatments and innovative therapies can be tested right next door at the largest, one of the largest clinics of the region and of the country, and it's very often that the researcher himself or herself runs practice at the clinic as a clinician. So it's a very tight and intense cooperation. And the innovation ecosystem was already mentioned, since the development strategy of this research institute has been elaborated this year. The next step is that we are preparing the innovation agenda for the next year, and we see that since the local industry and local innovation ecosystem is not very strong, and it's an understatement, we have to go international. So our plans are about an open innovation ecosystem, of course with the participation of local and national players, but truly trying to go international and establish an ecosystem which you can see here, because innovation ecosystem in this case for us is a very important perspective for the future. And now I would like to mention a partner in our innovation ecosystem, which is Bio4Dreams, and at this moment say a big thank you to you and personally to Fabio, because our cooperation started years ago. We are running some common projects, and the most important for me that we are planning a joint future in innovation ecosystem wise, and we truly believe that the contribution, the support from Bio4Dreams and especially Fabio's dedication and creativity and professionalism can facilitate and can help a lot when we are looking into the future. So thank you again for this contribution. What can be also important when we are talking about innovation, raising innovation potential of such a research institute which is dealing with science at this moment, the main thing is that what I can see besides the innovation ecosystem and identifying the partners and potential partners and players in this game, this is the culture of innovation, which is one of the first goals, and also it's a tool to enhance innovation potential and activity within our research center. So we are now focusing on at the first from the start to enhance somehow the culture of innovation. And besides the two or three or four research groups and projects who are already dealing with innovation projects, somehow to teach, somehow to show, somehow to demonstrate all the others that it's a real possibility for everyone. And it's not only about facilitating, but we are also introducing soon an innovation quality management system. So at this moment, we maintain a scientific quality management system where all the projects and outputs and groups evaluated yearly, on a yearly basis. And of course, there is a possibility to gain, and there is a possibility to lose some credits in this game. So we will introduce an innovation quality management system from January. And this will be also a tool to facilitate and enhance culture of innovation, because research groups will be set with some innovation targets of different type and will be evaluated regularly on a yearly basis. But besides that, of course, they will be included, engaged into the innovation ecosystem managed by Santa Agata Research Center. Our innovation activities will focus and are focusing on early innovation stages, because we are talking about science and research in the building. So what our task is from identifying ideas and helping, assisting them in planning and establishing concepts for a project until let's say, a proof of concept validation phase, which is maintained by the university or our other partners of the innovation ecosystem. So these are the basics of the development of our local innovation management system, launching formally from January. And you can see some of our partners at the first place, Bio4Dreams from Italy, and we have a very good partner with a little bit similar activities from Austria, and the new partner is we are planning to sign an agreement and run a joint research project from Israel. We have spin-off companies, we have the industrial partners from different fields of interest, and there are the list of the research infrastructures we are participating in members, and these will be also able to facilitate our efforts. And here are some models, typical models in an innovation and technology transfer we are working within. There are typical research and development operations. We are providing services for third parties. It can be academy or industry. I mentioned the core facility system. We have contracted with some industrial partners, strategic partnership agreements. We have some incubation and innovation partnerships, Bio4Dreams, for example. Again, there are the typical research and innovation or development grants we obtain for and finance our activities from, and there are product development projects also. Of course, these models are always overlooked, mostly, so two or three types are mixed in one project, but these models can be identified and offered for our partners in the future to participate. So this is where we are right now, and thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you, Vladimir, for letting us know what is happening in Hungary and Pécs in particular. By the way, I would like to let you know that this is not only just talks that we are doing today, but it's a truly operative activity that we are running. Just to give you one example, and I have to thank Engineer Bravar for this, a few months ago in Trieste, we started a talk, a cross-talk, like the title of our webinar, about engaging with different innovation players, for example, on the side of grants. And now we are planning to create an international grant office by putting together the different expertise in the different ecosystem. And I would like to further discuss also this with the Genova partners and University of Genova, because that way you can create best practices and join forces in order to create more valuable projects. And that's one simple pragmatic element that we can start discussing in order to really create this network of, let's say, applied innovation going forward. So moving ahead, thank you, Vladimir. And I would like to introduce Magdalena Kulcika from Poland, in particular from Krakow. She's the project manager of the Central European Bioforum. So thank you very much for being here, Magda, and I'm very happy to have you here. I know there is an issue with your presentation. So they should be bringing it forward remotely from here. But thank you again for being
here. Exactly. Okay, great. I hope you can hear me correctly.
So,
can you hear me?
Yes, very well.
Yeah, perfect. All right. Okay, technical issues are behind us, so I can welcome everyone and thank you, Fabio, very much for the introduction and invitation. I'm really glad to be here because I would like to tell you how we manage the networking that was mentioned beforehand as a Central European Bioforum. We are a biotech network platform. We don't have exactly this wonderful buildings that where we can drink coffee. No, we don't have that, unfortunately. But we try to, through our actions, to build and contribute to the development of the biotech sector in Poland and Central European Europe. Okay, next slide. So how does this Polish ecosystem look like? So this is, I cannot see if you can see it correctly, but...
It looks great here.
Okay, yes. I hope that you can see the names of the companies that are key players, that are key players in the biotech sector in Poland. And we are gathering them all together at the events that we organize. Okay, next slide. So I would like to tell you a bit of history, like who we are, really. And further on, I will tell you what do we do. So we are, we actually witnessed the development the development and the bringing up the Polish biotech that was born actually 20 years ago. And this is also when our platform was established. And therefore, I can truly say that we are the most recognized event in biotechnology sector in Poland, for sure, and almost in Central European Europe, because our fairs that were connecting the biotech companies, they were traveling all around the Central Europe. They were in Brno, in Budapest as well. So we've been there. But what is the, because what we believe in is this, what was mentioned beforehand, that networking is the key issue to create this innovation and to mix, you know, to mingle all the ideas. So then we can share our experiences. And we also try to, we understand this, it's not only about ideas, but also we need money. So we also try to bring on the foreign investors and to connect them with biotech companies. Okay, next slide. So how do we do that exactly? We do that through various actions. As I mentioned beforehand, we organized each year, we organized biofairs, of course, with an exception last year. But next year in May, I cordially invite you to our fairs that will have 20th edition already. We're 20 years old. So this is our biggest event that we organize, but we also we promote this networking through smaller events where we connect, as I mentioned before, investors, R&D and scientist people, and of course, we're also very important player, that is governmental representatives, that are making all the regulations that facilitate the development of the biotech companies, obviously. And currently, we also run many, many webinars, hashtagged Biotech Talks, so where we discuss various topics related to biotech. And I can see that it's even though it's virtual, then the connections are being made. So it's really something heartwarming for me, just as for Stefano, the scooter riders. excuse me. We also support the Association of Biotechnology Companies. Some of the companies that were mentioned already on the map. Because we believe that when we work in a group, then we have better, we have bigger strength of our voice that we speak up. For example, while talking with the governmental side. Okay, next slide. During our fairs, we also try to appreciate the contribution of the highly outstanding entities, scientists or companies or people who are contributing to the development of the biotech sector in Poland. Therefore, we established the SEA Biopharm Awards. And this year we also will have our edition with a few categories. And as we are talking with another field for connection, it's not only in the business to business, but also we need to remember that in order to run the business, you need a really good team. And as I speak to many, many representatives of the companies, they complain that, oh, it's so difficult with the really good people to conduct the projects. So we established the platform Biotech Talents in order to connect, you know, future workers and to overcome this barrier of hiring really good people, because we are, Poland is seen as one of the really highly experienced, as a market of highly experienced workers and scientists. So I think that, and I believed in it very strongly, that this human resource needs to be showed out and through our platform, for example. And the SEA Bioforum app is the last platform I would like to mention. It's our future plan, but it's we think about the platform for creating events where you can have your own profile and you have a series of events that you can attend to. Okay, next slide. But in particularly, may I ask for a next slide, please? Oh, no, that's too far. Yeah, what can we offer? There should be perfect. So, and here I just wanted to mention what particular actions we can offer to you as a foreign companies. So, since we know the biotech market in Poland, we can provide you expertise on this market. We can find the local partners for your business. For example, if you're looking for a Polish representative of your company, please come to us and we will find you the right partners. Then we can organize dedicated events in order to promote your company and to spread the information that, yes, you're here and you want to do the business, right? We also know which channels to use in order to promote your company in mass media. And you can also contribute to honoring this certain aspect by selecting a certain category of SEA Biopharm Award. And last night, so what do we want? Because it's also important to say out loud not only what we can offer to you, but also what we are looking for. So we are definitely, as I mentioned before, this networking is the key issue. So we would like to spread our network by getting to know more biomed companies that would like to cooperate internationally. We would like to know more innovation hubs. Of course, investors are welcome to contact us because we know a lot of companies, startups, that are looking for a first or second round of investment. And of course, we look for any projects for joint venture. And so then we could use our network to find the right partner for your project. So if you would like to get in touch with us, feel free to write to me. You can find me on LinkedIn, obviously. Write me an email. I would be very happy to answer your needs. And I look forward to collaboration with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Magda. And let me just briefly reconnect to what we said at the beginning. When you mentioned that in Italy we have great opportunities, but also fragmented ecosystem, we discussed about potential issues with technology transfer. The same problems are everywhere. The same problems are everywhere. And in the other ecosystem, we talked with, we heard talking private stakeholders, public stakeholders. They all have the same issue, and connecting together and joining forces is a key element for developing further projects. So thank you also for sharing your expertise. And this is a little step into what we are developing as a international hub network in the Eastern European countries, which is on one side the opportunity for joining forces, on the other side for scouting projects in this very fragmented ecosystem, which can somehow find a better way by joining their expertise. Now, let's move a bit away. Yeah, Magda?
May I? Yeah, just the last comment. I know by heart what you're talking about, because I worked in a tech transfer office. So I know how it is difficult to get together, but now there is an association of the tech transfers in Poland, and we as a C Bioforum, we cooperate with them. So we also have this insight into the universities as well. So,
which is another key element. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's now move away from Europe. Let's go into the United States first. And I'm very, very happy to have with us Dr. Lou Cassa, who is the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer of the Pennsylvania Biotech Center, and I just heard recently nominated future president, so congratulations, Lou. And please let us know a bit about what is happening in Pennsylvania, PABC, and in Philadelphia, and how do you envision this innovation cluster developing here in Europe? Thank you, Lou.
Absolutely, Fabio. And I do not have the share option screen, so we may have to do the same situation as we did before, if that's okay. If someone could forward the slides.
Okay, that's okay. We have to double check because I don't know whether they have. You have the presentation? Avete la presentazione? Okay, yes, we should be able to do that. Just a second.
Sure, thank you. And I would like to just thank you for the opportunity, Fabio, and it's been a really enlightening and educational experience for me, at least hearing what's going on everywhere outside of the US. It's very exciting, and we're very interested. I'm going to give a presentation on what's going on in the greater Philadelphia region, and also what we're about at the Pennsylvania Biotechnology Center, which is a life sciences incubator. So if we can go to the next slide, I want to talk a little bit about how we operate. So most incubators in the States are either run by universities. Some do it very well, Stanford, MIT, but a majority of them don't really have the know-how, the budget, or the experience to commercialize and move a lot of the academic technologies out. So the university incubator has been hit or miss here in the States. As I said, there's some good models, but there's a lot of models that could, you know, use a lot of assistance. The other side of the coin is we have a lot of real estate developers who are now, especially since the pandemic, pivoting towards life sciences and turning office space into lab space. There's pros and cons to that. Usually it's a very nice facility, but the services and once again, the know-how, I want to keep focusing on that for company success just really isn't there. What I'd like to present to you is really what our model is at the Pennsylvania Biotechnology Center, and then how we are pretty much expanding that model into other areas and other life sciences clusters. If you can go to the next slide, it will tell you that you know, we have three very distinct nonprofits. This is the three related complementary nonprofits. And that's a key part of our model. So before I get into the weeds here, you know, this is really a platform that we're utilizing. We have 8 or 9 ingredients that we believe is a blueprint for success. And one of the first ingredients is we're a nonprofit. So we are at the heart, we're a research institute center. Our parent organization is the Hepatitis B Foundation. It's a public policy advocacy organization. It's very small, 15 or 16 people, but it's very impactful. It is the go-to hepatitis B organization in the States, and it actually reaches internationally. We have over 3 million visitors to our website. The Blumberg Institute is the key nonprofit, I would say, because that houses our management services, and it's a research institute. So we focus on liver cancer and hepatitis B research, but we've diversified over the last few years to prostate, more platform mRNA, breast cancer. And here's the key part of how our operation works. The research center supervises and runs our biotech center. So when you think about it this way, we are in the community. We are one of the largest members. We have 11 labs. We have 70 employees. We've got 9 to 10 principal investigators. It changes that dynamic that we, you know, we don't use the word tenant landlord. We have a community here that with, you know, 3 nonprofits at the heart, but really a research institute that is managing it. If you can go to the next slide, and it talks a little bit about some of our success that I can you know, elaborate a little bit more on. But we were, there was a big study done in 2018 by the International Business Innovation Association. There's approximately in the States 150 to 160 life sciences incubators. We ranked across the board in the top 3. We were number 1 in some areas, revenue on site. At that time, we had $1.75 billion for guidance. That number is now north of $2 billion company value valuations. And you know, the number of stakeholders and partners, we really believe to be a successful incubator, you need to have as many partnerships as possible and be inclusive. One of our ingredients is academic entrepreneur programs. We have, you know, affiliations with over 12 universities, high schools, and colleges. That makes us a knowledge community. And once again, our mission is focusing on company success. And when we focus on that, everything else seems to fall in place. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. The next slide will give you a little bit more of an overview of what exactly is going on at the Pennsylvania Biotechnology Center. We have 50 companies on site. Before the pandemic, we had 41. Research and demand is booming right now. We have 88 total member companies, but that means 88 members. We've got about 50 companies that are on site. We have what's called memberships, where other companies want to be part of our community, come to the events, come to the seminars. They get a mailbox. They get to use our conference rooms. We have a new $20 million building, which is a beautiful picture right there on the slide. That is opening up October 15th. 37,000 square feet. It will double our lab space. Good news, bad news. We're at full capacity when we open doors in the middle of October. The bad news is we have a waiting list of about a dozen companies we have to find an answer for. And I'm working with our state legislators and some other developers regarding that. We've had 6 IPOs on site in 15 years. That's pretty tremendous. Considering we're in Doylestown, Pennsylvania, and I'll talk about our location in a second. And once again, top 3 incubator. About 3 months ago, another industry publication came out with this study. We were ranked 10 out of 15. We were in front of Mission Bay Capital, and we were pretty much the only incubator outside of Boston in that top 15. If you go to the next slide, which is our ingredients, I'll mention some of them. As we did say nonprofit. And this is probably the most important, and I've heard this theme throughout the presentations I've seen today. It's all about the ecosystem. And I want to talk about how we can build on our ecosystem, especially, you know, discussions I've had with Fabio. There's some very interesting possibilities with what's going on in other parts of Europe and in the world. But we focus on the ecosystem, number one, if you're going to come into our incubator. How can you make it better? It's more of an art form, but, you know, is it the type of science you're bringing in? We believe that a diverse ecosystem and having many different sizes and shapes makes the other companies better. It accelerates the science. Most companies collaborate with 3 or 4 other companies in our ecosystem. We are in it. Once again, we are in the ecosystem. So we work with about a dozen companies. We get to know them very well. And here's a really key catch. We don't kick companies out of our ecosystem. The general incubator model, which is fine, you know, everyone has their specific models, is usually 1 to 2 years in the States, and then they kick you out. Here, if you're going to focus on an ecosystem, we want senior companies. We want proof of concept companies because they play well. We have senior companies who will go on the younger companies' boards. They'll invest. They'll give advice. There's equipment. You know, our model has pretty much on the East Coast the most common equipment of any incubator that we have. I mean, we have PCRs, MMRs, confocal microscopes, centrifuges, autoclaves. All that's included without any upcharge in our model because we really want the scientists to focus on the science. So it's really interesting when you look at the ecosystem, and that I'll show you on the next slide. We'll hold off on a second. How we believe our ecosystem and the co-collaboration has made this one of the most successful incubators in the U.S. The academic entrepreneur environment, we have a full-scale high school program on site. 39 students from our local high school come on site every day to take advanced chemistry in a classroom. And here's the great part. They then go into the incubator. They have mentors from the companies, and they do one of the best experiential learning programs in the States, doing hands-on research. They have to sign NDAs, and it's not like when you go to science class and you know how the experiment ends. They're actually doing world-class research. And this is, we've been doing this program for 3 years. We have kids that have been going to MIT, Stanford, and last year we had a student win a full PhD scholarship to Purdue, one of 50,000 students who applied. So it's a pretty tremendous program. But we also have master's in biotech program, first year med school program with a very significant healthcare system, master's in chemistry with Penn. So the more partners, the better. But what that creates is a knowledge community. And it also gives our 50 companies an extra set of hands and some extra help in the labs. And when I meet with the companies every year and say, what can we do better to help you out? They always thank us for the students. It's something that I've been to Penn and Hopkins and Princeton. We actually have more students on site than any of the universities in our area. We had over 100 students on site pre-pandemic. As I mentioned, it's all about our services. We're services heavy. Most people don't understand. This is not a real estate play, and that's what scares me. I'll talk more about the greater Philadelphia region because we're going to have over 2 million square feet of lab space in the next 2 years. And if we don't have the right ecosystem and services in place, we're going to have a lot of empty lab space. But the demand is there, and I'll talk a little bit more. I mentioned the common equipment and in funding opportunities. I just heard from a couple of the previous talks. We are raising a $50 million Hatch Bio Fund right now to invest in our incubators. I'll talk more about our second incubator in a second. We felt that if we would have been investing from the beginning, it would have generated potentially hundreds of millions of dollars of windfall that we could have applied towards our nonprofit and more research and more scientists. So no one's pocketing this money. We're really looking at it to accelerate our mission, which is to cure hepatitis B and liver cancer. If we can go to the next slide, this is my favorite one. You can see that there's a Cambridge Associates study came out, and it basically said the average time to exit in for an early stage company. And what does that mean? That could be an acquisition, IPO, and are you just your revenue generating? You go off on your own and you graduate. The average time in the States is 8 years. And that's pretty good time. Small molecules, life science, it does take some traction. The average return is 2.5. We had an independent study done by Century Consulting 2 years ago, and it found out that the average time at the Pennsylvania Biotech Center was 3.5 years. So we were able to almost take 5 years off that successful exit. And once again, we put a lot of that on our collaboration, the services, the common equipment, the funding mechanisms. So while we're raising the fund, we also have a Rolodex and relationships with upwards of, 12 to 15 other VCs, angels, high net individuals. I always tell our team, if a company gets stuck here, if they're in the valley of death, their third to fifth year, it's our job to get them unstuck. So instead of charging them extra if they're late on rent or worrying, we want to get them help. So we'll make these connections, we'll make these meetings. And, one out of 20 companies in the States is successful in biotech. Here, we've yet to have a company fail in the 8 years I've been here. We have some companies that may have some trouble staying above water, but we try to get them going and make the right connections. If you go to the next slide, please. This talks a little bit more about the greater Philadelphia area. We are at a tremendous opportunity here. And I just want to make sure everyone understands from a geographic point of view. We are in the heart of the Pharma Belt in Doylestown, Pennsylvania. We're 30 miles north of Philadelphia. We're 40 miles west of Princeton. We're the only incubator in the country that has companies from Princeton and Penn. We've been at full capacity for 8 years. And we have a tremendous opportunity with the cell and gene therapy and regenerative medicine that's going on in the city. In two slides, I'll give you more firsthand because I've been doing tours. We have a new incubator that we're opening.
But you have a couple of minutes, Lou, more. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll hustle here. But we're now seeing companies from San Francisco, Boston, across the country at the PABC. We have our first San Francisco company start in May. We have another company in November and a Boston company. The gene and cell therapy is really booming. We're fourth in the NIH in funding, fifth in patents. We're always ranked between 5 and 9 in the life sciences clusters, but we need more state assistance. We're trying to work on that for more incentives. We do have the talent and the resource, and we do have, as I mentioned, lab space. If you can go to the next slide, it talks about the pharma belt. Within Doylestown, within 100 miles of Doylestown, is 70% of all pharma. In the greater Philadelphia region, within 2 hours, we have 70% of all the scientific talent and pharma in this region. So it is a hotbed for resources. It's our shame for not really leveraging how much the pharma belt from North Jersey down to Philadelphia has as far as resources. The next slide is we are opening up a new incubator using our model. It's called B Labs at the Cira Center. It's at University City in Philadelphia. We're on the doorstep of Penn, and we have seen, once again, companies from all around the country, 75% of them are regenerative medicine, and we have the two top docs from Penn spinning their companies out at this incubator, along with some other academic technology from CHOP and Jefferson, and we actually have a company from Gothenburg, Sweden, who does transplants that's interested in doing their R&D here in Philadelphia. Finally, the next slide is opportunities. You know, we are a magnet for cell therapy. We do want to expand our ecosystem. We've been in discussions with Fabio and Bio4Dreams about how can we have more of a bridge two ways from the EU and from other countries to the country, and especially the Philadelphia region, and also back the other way. The other lab markets are very overpriced and maxed out. We have the ability in Philadelphia that you could start with one bench and you can keep your company within a couple blocks because of all the lab space that's being developed. So you can go from one bench to commercialization all within a few blocks of B Labs and within the Philadelphia region. So yeah, there's a tremendous amount of opportunity. We're starting to see more VC and more money come into the area. And I really think the one takeaway from the greater Philadelphia area is we're at a tipping point. And within the next 2 years, I think Philadelphia is going to move up in the life sciences clusters and market, and we're going to have a lot more regenerative medicine companies in our ecosystem. So thank you for the opportunity again, Fabio. Sorry for if
I thank you. No, thank you very much. And one key message that I bring on is that with respect to what happens many times in incubators that are real estate operations where you have to go and in 3 years you have to get away, probably we have to think about the fact that maybe have some companies develop in the incubator, that stay in the incubator, become a driver for the other projects as well. And this is, I guess, a concept that I would like to bring home as a take-home message today. So thank you, Lou, and I look forward to do great things in Philadelphia and Doylestown area with you in the near future. And now let's take the plane and let's go on the other side, actually in Milano, because Yang is in Milano, but he is the investment manager of the Sino-Italy Ningbo Ecological Industrial Park. So thank you very much, Yang, for being with us today. Grazie mille per essere con noi, Yang. E ti lascio la parola, ci racconti il Sino-Italy Ningbo Ecological Park.
Grazie mille. Vedete la mia...
Sì, vediamo.
Ok. Buongiorno a tutti, mi chiamo Jian Hongbin, lavoro per Sino Italy Ningbo Ecological Park in Italia. Sono molto lieto di partecipare a questo evento e di fare questa presentazione. Allora, Sino Italy Ningbo Ecological Park è nato dal patto che ha stipulato il governo italiano con la Cina nel 2014. L'11 dicembre 2015 il parco è stato fondato a Yuyao, vicino a Ningbo, per diventare uno dei 8 parchi industriali ecologici di cooperazione internazionale a livello nazionale. Il parco è geograficamente favorevole dal punto di vista delle posizioni. Si trova nella regione più ricca della Cina, il delta del fiume Yangtze. Questa regione è la zona economica più grande e il centro più importante della Cina ed è la base di produzione avanzata più importante del mondo e anche centro da un punto di vista prettamente geometrico delle tre importanti città di Shanghai, Hangzhou e Ningbo. in 2 ore in macchina o treno si può raggiungere dal parco a Shanghai, Hangzhou, Ningbo, inclusi 4 aeroporti, due punti che attraversano il mare di queste 3 città. Le autostrade e le ferrovie sono integrate nella rete stradale nazionale. Il parco occupa 40 km quadrati e 26 sono già in costruzione. Abbiamo 4 settori principali di cui il parco si occupa, che sono automobile, vita e salute, risparmio energetico ed attrezzatura di alta gamma. Stiamo anche costruendo una zona per i progetti di alto contenuto tecnologico. Il parco e BioDreams hanno raggiunto una partnership strategica nel 2020. La partnership è dedicata a supportare lo sviluppo dei progetti di life science di BioDreams in Cina. Stiamo cercando di creare un meccanismo che generi di continuo opportunità per le aziende italiane di life science per entrare in Cina, per esempio, il parco offre una serie di servizi, supporti e politiche preferenziali. Dunque, cosa offre il parco alle aziende? Prima di tutto, offre tutte le infrastrutture necessarie allo sviluppo. C'è una zona dedicata per le piccole e medie imprese dell'Europa centrale e orientale. Gli edifici industriali, Euro standard per le imprese italiane ed europee sono dotate di edifici completi, dormitorio, mensa e altri benefit. Vi è inoltre una zona residenziale commerciale che si chiama il Centro di Scambio Culturale Sino-Italiano, generando integrazione tra le funzioni di commercio, finanza, mostra e hotel, con un investimento totale di 260 milioni di euro. È un'area pianificata di 140.000 metri quadrati. Per aiutare le aziende straniere e locali del nostro parco, abbiamo acquistato un palazzo a Shanghai che dista 700 metri dall'aeroporto e dalla stazione di treno ad alta velocità di Hongqiao. A 6 piani, conta poco meno di 8.000 metri quadrati, ha principalmente 3 funzioni. Uno è fare promozione, possiamo esporre ad esempio video e prodotti delle aziende al piano terra e possiamo formare il nostro personale e presentarne per le aziende. Possiamo promuovere le aziende integrandole negli eventi industriali che organizzeremo nel nostro palazzo. Sebbene non siamo in Cina, si può realizzare comunque una presenza nel mercato cinese. Due sono servizi di ufficio one stop, nel senso che nel nostro palazzo offriamo diversi spazi per co-working, sale riunione, uffici high-end e abbiamo anche diverse sale per organizzare gli eventi al massimo di 100 invitati. Dre è una piattaforma di integrazione delle risorse commerciali. Il parco offre diverse politiche preferenziali, soprattutto quando si tratta di un progetto italiano. Diamo sempre la massima libertà, offriamo più supporto possibile. Il parco ha diversi fondi che possiamo usare per investimenti in progetti situati nel nostro parco, di tutte le grandezze, sia per le start-up, spin-off, che per le aziende mature. Possiamo aiutare le aziende italiane anche con prestiti alle banche cinesi, eccetera. Il parco fornisce incentivi fiscali sia per le aziende che per i talenti di alto livello per al massimo 5 anni, sussidi per affitti e macchinari e equipaggiamenti acquistati, premi per i progetti di alta tecnologia al massimo di 5 milioni di RMB. Il parco offre lo sconto sul prezzo di terreno, il servizio di costruzione tailor-made. Poi il parco offre anche alle aziende straniere il supporto industriale, nel senso che il parco, insieme con molti soci importanti di diversi settori, tipologie, enti pubblici, imprese, università, eccetera, condivide le risorse con le aziende straniere, creando un meccanismo di cooperazione stabile, aiutando le nostre aziende a fare la conoscenza del mercato cinese. Trovare i fornitori e clienti in Cina ad un costo minimo. Ultimamente abbiamo avviato con successo diverse cooperazioni, anche in piena pandemia. Siamo rimasti operativi, siamo riusciti a aiutare le aziende italiane a raggiungere accordi con le aziende cinesi, per esempio nel settore aeronautico, e ora stanno per costruire una joint venture per cominciare lo sviluppo nel mercato cinese. Inoltre abbiamo avviato anche le costruzioni delle fabbriche delle aziende italiane del settore automobile dopo pochi mesi dallo scoppio della pandemia. Dunque crediamo di poter fare successo anche nel settore di life science. Questo è tutto. Spero di essere utile per voi e grazie ancora per l'attenzione.
Grazie mille. E direi che questo workshop secondo me è stato molto utile per vedere come in diversi ecosistemi pubblici, privati, siano necessarie tutte le componenti, come dicevamo all'inizio, sia necessaria la componente di ricerca, la finanza, il partner privato, per lavorare in sinergia, per creare la massa critica sufficiente per poter portare a valore i risultati, che altrimenti rimangono troppo frammentati. Quindi questo di oggi vuole essere un po' un primo punto di partenza per poter costruire questo ecosistema strutturato, sovranazionale, paneuropeo di ricerca. Direi, siamo partiti da Genova, torniamo a Genova per chiudere il progetto. Cosa dici?
Sì, allora abbiamo fatto un viaggio meraviglioso, siamo partiti dall'Italia, ci siamo spostati in Europa, quindi USA, China. Abbiamo detto che la ricerca è internazionale e internazionale deve essere il suo sbocco. Chiedo gentilmente al professor Fulvio Mastrogiovanni, ricordo prorettore all'internazionalizzazione dell'Università di Genova, sì, se ci fa un commento di chiusura grazie anche alla sua esperienza come prorettore all'internazionalizzazione di quello che ha visto e sentito.
Ok, should I speak in English for our friends? So first of all, I mean thank you for having me here and would like to thank you I mean it. In any case, I think we saw many things in my experience, both in this role, but also as someone who likes to exit from the lab and being engaged, no, in the real, I mean, world and environment and the market. I think we have to highlight three keywords that were in my mind, which I briefly say. First of all, we always need an international strategy. I mean, it's very important that locally we are not used to have it. So we think that everything comes out because you have relationship, but we need to have a relationship with some strategy. I like the word ecosystem that you put forward. I like the fact that you mentioned, for instance, the fact that all of the research entities now on the region are quite here. Another important issue, in my opinion, is the alignment between the need of the territory and what the politics is actually pursuing. In my experience, this is fundamental, and I think it was also a somewhat not so hidden factor in the experiences that we said. So when there is alignment between the political wishes and the capabilities of the territory, of course, you can have some step change in how you're performing things. And another thing is the territory. So the territory is very important, especially we saw in the presentation with our friends from Pennsylvania. Here, for instance, we have a very peculiar territory. So there is one joke I typically say when I present my university, I mean worldwide, we are 6 centuries old. And they say, yes, but in 6 centuries, you were not able to build a campus. Because we can't. So we need to distribute in the territory innovation. So we cannot have a district. In my opinion.
Let me interrupt you because
please,
this is what happened in Pennsylvania. When they made the building, the first thing they did was to talk with the local Pennsylvania senator so that the senator would write each single request coming from the innovation ecosystem, what they needed, and bring those on door to the state level. So that interaction is fundamental.
It's
as
fundamental.
A keyword. Yes.
Fundamental. Mm-hmm. And I close saying that in this case, it's very fundamental. And I'm not directly involved in this, but one of my dreams for the territory which we are talking about is to have a complete innovation district, which is superimposed with the city and the main region, of course. So, thank you very much.
Grazie a tutti. Grazie per averci ascoltati. Siamo il centro del mondo per l'internazionalizzazione degli spin-off e delle start-up. E a vostra disposizione. Grazie.
Grazie a tutti ancora.